Hello, my name is Marisa Montoya. I am an assistant professor at the Complutense University in Madrid, where I work in the field of tipping elements of the Earth system. It is my pleasure to introduce you to two experts in this field, who are Peter Ditlevsen, professor at the University of Copenhagen, and Niklas Boers, professor at the Technical University in Munich. Both of them are coordinators of an EU-funded project called TIPIS, which aims at investigating tipping elements of the Earth system precisely. So let's go with some questions.
So tipping elements are subsystems or parts of the Earth system where we have, for some reason, either from empirical evidence or more theoretical reasons, we assume that they are at least bistable or multistable, meaning they can, for similar climate boundary conditions, they can attain qualitatively very different states. And these are definitely strongly nonlinear systems, and the transitions between the different states would be comparably abrupt. Examples of those are the polar ice sheets, where there is due to different feedbacks, there can be an accelerated melt response. There is an ocean circulation system called the AMOC, the Atlantic Meridional Orbiturning Circulation, where feedback is induced by salt being attracted to the North Atlantic, making the water masses heavier, leading to enhanced sinking, which accelerates this flow. And if then there is, for example, too much freshwater inflow from melting Greenland ice sheet and enhanced hydrological cycle, then that feedback would be threatened. And then there's a risk that this whole ocean circulation could collapse. Or the Amazon rainforest, where we find for the same precipitation regimes, we find rainforest or savanna states. And there we also assume that we can have abrupt transitions between them just due to noise, in that case, droughts or fires.
What happens with the tipping point is that things can enhance effects, like these positive feedbacks are situations where, say, more ice reflects more sunlight, which means that the surface becomes colder, which means there'll be more ice, and this is a positive feedback that goes on. But it could just as well go the other way. Less ice would give more open ocean that would suck up the heat, melt more ice, and the other way. So you would never see the situation in which the positive feedbacks that I describe here dominates. You would always be in a state where negative feedbacks, they dominate so that it's stable. But in this case, where you have such a positive feedback somewhere, you can have two different states going one way or the other. And if you destabilize the negative feedbacks that keep you in place, you're in the risk of jumping to the other unwanted state. So that is the nature of a tipping point. It's something that we see in the theories we have on these subsystems, those tipping elements. We try to understand when exactly we are in risk of this happening. When are we in a sort of safely away from the tipping elements? For that, we require climate models that can run future scenarios. But these models, it turns out, are not very good at reproducing tipping elements. So we could ask ourselves, well, is this then just a result of our imagination or too simplified models? And we think not, because if we go back in prehistoric climates, of course, we don't have temperature measurements and so on, but we can indirectly see how climate has been in, you know, the abundance of different species or tree rings that are thicker or thinner depending on temperature, or the isotopic composition of ice in ice cores and other what we call proxy records. There we can see that in prehistoric time, there have been several very, very abrupt climate shifts that we attribute to tipping points. So we do believe that these are real, and we are could be in real risk of hitting some of these.
So yeah, I fully agree with Peter. There's sort of three possible lines of evidence. The one is theory, the other one is past, what happened in the past, so-called paleoclimate reconstructions, because they're not technically observations. And the third is our comprehensive sort of attempts to create copies of the real world in terms of like very complicated and complex Earth system models. And the paleoclimate proxy evidence it's very clear that abrupt climate changes have happened in the past. And the theory is also very clear about that. And there has been a time where the comprehensive models had really severe difficulties in reproducing this past abrupt transitions. I think that in the last few years, there has been quite promising work where it could be shown that indeed past abrupt transitions can be reproduced if the models are calibrated well with respect to the climate conditions from back then. Yes, there's different ways. Let's say as long as the models aren't in a state where we can really fully trust them that they give us reliable answers, the one thing we have to resort to is observational data or proxy reconstructions. But in this case, no, mainly observational data. There is certain characteristics how the time series that result from these observations, how these time series behave as the system approaches a critical threshold. We speak of the system loses stability gradually already on the way to that tipping point. And that is something we can, under some conditions, and there's also a lot of development still to be done, but under some conditions, we can derive estimators that at least tell us we've been moving closer to a tipping point, and we can relate that then to possible forcings and possible drivers and see if it is plausible. And that is... So that is what we can do. And of course, we want to combine that then with comprehensive models and see if we find consistent results. But that's state-of-the-art research and future research, basically.
Yes, I think we are actually in a situation where we can have crossed some of the thresholds that would be related to tropical forest and also related to the ice sheets. And we're in much concern about the ice sheets because when they melt or collapse, the sea level will rise, and that has strong implications for life on the near ocean land masses and where people live. But we also know now that the speed at which we approach a tipping point, I mean, how fast we are heating the planet, has an influence on how this tipping is done. And we also know that it's not too late to return, even though we might have passed the tipping point. So the rate at which we change things could also let us back to a more safe situation, but that would of course take very strong measures. So we in the community, we use this sort of simple picture from the cartoons that if you run over the cliff in free air, if you're fast enough, you might be able to make it back in. And this is a real thing. You might think of the big ice sheets, the Greenland ice sheet, what happens there is that when it gets warmer, it melts, and the top of the ice mountain gets lower down. And when it gets lower down, the atmosphere is warmer, and that increases the melting, and then it would in principle be able to collapse. But that lowering of the top of the ice sheet, that's a very slow process, which means that we could reverse it, even though we might have passed the tipping point where it would be gone if we keep heating the atmosphere. We would need to stop heating the atmosphere with greenhouse gas emissions. We are now up at almost doubling the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere since pre-industrial times, and that is a severe pressure on the climate system as we know it. So if we want to stay with the climate that we know, we have to do very strong measures on that. I mean, the world has been warm before. I mean, the dinosaurs, they lived in a much warmer world than we do. So it's not that we are in the best of all climates. We are just in the climate that we know. And we cannot migrate across borders if it gets too hot in the tropical areas, and we cannot just migrate into the mountains if sea level rises and so on, because the speed at which we might be changing the climate if we hit tipping points is much too fast for us to handle in a safe way for society.
I would even say, even without tipping points and without tipping elements, the speed is too fast. Sort of the pace at which we're warming the planet is unprecedented. And there is no way for ecosystems, societies, and so on to adapt. And of course, these overshoots, so there is for different of these tipping elements, there is windows of opportunity, as Peter explained. For some, like the Greenland ice sheet, these windows of opportunity are long, maybe hundreds. I mean, you could probably get away with warming the planet above the actual critical threshold, the tipping point of Greenland, and you could stay above that for 100 years if you then stabilize the temperatures back below the critical threshold. But for other tipping elements like the Amazon rainforest, who are just which act at very much faster timescales, then these windows of opportunity are much shorter. And there is certainly also already tipping elements like the coral reefs or Arctic sea ice that are basically already where the thresholds are either already crossed or they will certainly be crossed in the coming decades, and there the windows of opportunity are too narrow. So these parts of the climate system are basically already committed to change to the other states that then cause other changes. And of course, Peter's fully right. So the one thing we need to do is stop or reduce greenhouse gas emissions as quickly as possible and by as much as possible, become climate neutral ideally before 2050, or CO2 neutral. And for the Amazon rainforest, there's a second option, just stop deforestation, stop land use change. But for all the others, it's really mainly the greenhouse gas emissions and the resulting warming of the atmosphere that causes the problem. And that with every kilogram of CO2 that we additionally admit to the atmosphere, we move closer towards those critical thresholds. Even if we don't know where they are precisely, we know we're moving closer. So that is, for a system that you don't really understand that well, that you can make quantitative predictions where the critical points are, that doesn't mean you shouldn't be cautious and just try to stay away from the critical thresholds as much as possible, as far as possible.
A nice analogy I saw from a colleague was this, that you're on a loft, a dark loft, and there's this opening that you can fall through. You don't know where it is, So the best strategy would be stop walking around until you can identify where it is.